Prova. Prova. Ci siamo. We are ready to start. Good morning to everybody. And I would like to start the work of this morning by inviting our Vice Rector of the University of Rome La Sapienza, Professor Renato Masiani, to say your his greetings. Let me also invite at the desk Professor Luca Ribichini, that is the dean of our faculty, that today hosts our event, and Dr. Gabriele Kreutzer-Lenz, that is the general director of the Goethe Institute of Italy. And the architect Ottaviano De Gidio, that is the director of the Cultural Association of Sala 1, the exposition room that will host the exposition tomorrow. And we don't have here Architetto Massimo Bagatti, but for the AMA, the municipal company of hygiene of Rome, and he will be substituted in the greetings by Architect Panei. And please, Professor Masiani, let's start our works.
Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti. Un breve saluto, non di circostanza. Devo intanto ringraziare i convenuti qui, nonostante il clima che non è certo favorevole a spostarsi per Roma. Oggi non è una bella giornata per farlo. Però devo ringraziare soprattutto chi ha organizzato questa giornata, incominciando dalla collega e amica Patrizia Dovalusci, ma anche ai gentili ospiti convenuti dall'Italia e da fuori Italia, all'Università di Weimar, il Goethe Institute, che ringraziamo, e anche l'AMA, con la quale devo dire noi da anni, perché ormai sono anni, abbiamo un rapporto stretto. Io credo di essere stato io a firmare il primo accordo nel 2014 di collaborazione con l'AMA, con cui si è avviata questa attività sul riuso e sul problema del riutilizzo dei materiali, non più diciamo rifiuti, ma oggi il termine non è quello corretto, convenzione che è stata rinnovata da pochissimi giorni. Io di questo sono, devo dire, molto contento e molto soddisfatto, perché penso che sia veramente una collaborazione importante. Naturalmente il tema del riuso, il tema dell'economia circolare, ma diciamo più in generale il tema della sostenibilità di tutte le attività, anche a quelle architettoniche e quelle di una città grande come Roma, ovviamente è un tema fondamentale, un tema sul quale la Facoltà di Architettura e Sapienza si esercita e lavora da molto tempo, con varie forme, coinvolgendo gli studenti nell'attività dei laboratori, nell'attività di progettazione, nell'attività di laurea, ma anche i docenti. Ovviamente ne abbiamo qui degli esempi su un tema, ripeto, che è fondamentale, sul quale c'è ancora molto da fare. Non siamo ancora arrivati ovviamente al risultato finale, ma è un tema ineludibile. E su questo tema di ricerca scientifica e anche didattica e formativa La Sapienza si sta impegnando, si impegna e continuerà a impegnarsi con i dipartimenti della Scuola di Architettura, della Facoltà di Architettura, ma non solo, anche con gli altri dipartimenti che compongono la compagine scientifica di Sapienza. Io non vorrei portare via altro tempo a questa mattinata che si annuncia intensa, e quindi auguro a tutti quanti buon lavoro e ringrazio di nuovo di essere qui convenuti.
Buongiorno, sono Luca Ribichini, il vicepreside. Porto i saluti di Anna Maria Giovenale, che è la preside della nostra facoltà, che appunto, dato il tempo, devo dire, credo che abbia avuto delle difficoltà a arrivare, ma forse magari più tardi sarà presente qui insieme a noi. Ma io direi che come facoltà abbiamo l'onore e il piacere di poter ospitare queste giornate di riflessione, di studio, diciamo su tre ordini di argomenti. Innanzitutto la nostra professoressa, la Trovalucci, è stata assolutamente brava e in grado di riuscire a mettere insieme tante competenze e tanti modi diversi, e questo credo che sia uno degli elementi importanti, che si parla del fatto del noi e non del io, no? Del fatto di avere questo senso di inclusione, soprattutto nell'ambito della ricerca, dello studio e della conoscenza. E io credo che questo sia uno degli elementi fondamentali che sta alla base proprio del sapere. Questo fatto ha portato a un rinnovo assolutamente di primo piano tra l'AMA e la Facoltà di Architettura, e vorrei dire che unisce due elementi che spesso vengono dimenticati, che sono la pratica e la teoria, che era un modo, dico, antico. Addirittura c'è una rappresentazione a Notre Dame e anche altre statue, in cui rappresentano esattamente la conoscenza, la filosofia, che è dato da due libri, esattamente e sono indicati da due lettere greche, pratica e teoria, ovvero sia questi due elementi possono riuscire insieme effettivamente a fare la differenza. Uno non può essere disgiunto dall'altro, e in questo caso questo tipo di convenzione credo che porti proprio a portare allo studio, ma per poi avere un'applicazione assolutamente vera, reale, che possa essere spesa. L'altro ordine di riflessione è alla Bauhaus, che sono 100 anni, quindi è una istituzione assolutamente di primissimo piano, dove ha legato esattamente arte e design. E in questo senso io credo che sia un elemento importante questo recupero, che per diversi aspetti si è un po' perso, di recuperare il senso proprio dell'arte, che è uno degli elementi fondamentali. Troppo spesso si è andato seguendo l'aspetto squisitamente pratico e senza pensare che all'interno dei componimenti dell'essere umano c'è una parte emozionale, emotiva, che è importante. Quindi questo credo che sia una delle cose più importanti, e assolutamente la Bauhaus rappresenta un'eccellenza assoluta in questo caso. E in terzo vorrei ricordare il Goethe Institute, che noi abbiamo già avuto, lo diceva il prorettore, che già ci sono stati tutta una serie di rapporti importanti. Ricordo una mostra che è stata fatta alla biblioteca della Facoltà di Architettura, molto importante, interessante, dove sono stati presenti tantissimi studenti nostri. Ecco, io credo che tutto questo poi alla fine mette insieme le diverse competenze e i diversi saperi, che credo che alla fine porta sicuramente a un miglioramento. E io credo in questo, e quindi grazie alla vostra presenza che è stata in questa facoltà. Grazie di tutto.
Let me just invite our professor Anna Irene Del Monaco, who will translate slightly for the students from Germany.
Well, the teacher very much briefly, because
the beginning
I was advised in the middle of this,
and the vice rector of Sapienza, of our institution, Sapienza University.
Just a quick summary, for especially for the German students, because I heard that the professor know quite well Italian, or are able to understand. Both our vice rector and our vice dean were very pleased to, of course, welcome you and encourage this collaboration, because for sure it is grounded in tradition of our cities. I mean, this kind of studies and this kind of approach to the project is not born today or in the last decades, but dates back to the early stage of what today we call architecture, and before maybe was called in another way. Professor Ribichini was mentioned some painting in in Notre Dame de Paris. We have to think about that even important parks in Paris, like the Tuileries or Botte-Chamont, where previously landfill and then were transformed in parks. So we have a lot of example in our European cities of cities and part of cities that were transformed. Some important aspect of this joint research is the environmental, commitment and the interdisciplinary commitment to. Patrizia Trovalucci's commitment in our school is a clear demonstration. She's a professor of mechanics structural mechanics, and so she tries to involve every time architects and professor of technology. So the interdisciplinarity aspect is fundamental. The presence of Bauhaus recalls also the importance of the artistic approach to this subject. So we broaden the interdisciplinary field, which is usually more technical around architecture, also to the artistic sphere. And to broaden deeply also the multidisciplinary sphere, the presence of the Goethe Institute, of course, means much more of the joint collaboration between the institutions that are present in Rome and that represent Europe in the best possible way. Thank you.
Let me now invite Dr. Kreuzer Lenz, who will introduce the Goethe Institute.
Buongiorno a tutti, guten Morgen. Io voglio parlare in italiano e anche in tedesco, perché io penso che l'inglese sarebbe un po' strano, perché siamo qui le tedeschi, no? A questa parte. Dove sono gli studenti da Germania? Wo sind die deutschen Studenten? Benvenuti in Italia. Io sono molto felice che siamo qui in questa sala fantastica, che io per la prima volta io sono qui e io sono veramente impressionata. È una cosa che mi sembra a Roma sempre così, quando entro in un edificio a volte io vedo delle cose così che sono fantastiche. Ich habe gesagt, es ist unglaublich hier in Rom, wenn man in Paläste kommt, dann sieht man diese Schönheit, dass man von draußen zum Teil gar nicht vermutet. Il Goethe-Institut ha fatto un programma speciale su Bauhaus, perché quest'anno, come voi tutti sapete, sono 100 anni il giubileo di Bauhaus, che c'era un cambio totale e ancora oggi è molto importante. Ich habe gerade gesagt, dass das Goethe-Institut einige Programme hier in Italien macht zum Bauhaus, zu dem 100-jährigen Jubiläum, was für uns alle, für die ganze Welt wichtig war. Noi abbiamo cominciato con un film e una lezione magistrale in Maxi. Abbiamo continuato con una conferenza sulle donne Bauhaus, che hanno avuto un ruolo molto, molto importante. Siamo oggi in questa fantastica università, in questa sala splendida, con una conferenza interessante. Domani facciamo l'esposizione degli studenti dell'Università di Weimar, di Bauhaus. E abbiamo fatto anche una esposizione con il RUFA, che voi sicuramente conoscete. Ich habe gerade erzählt, dass wir verschiedene Veranstaltungen gemacht haben, eine Ausstellung, wir haben eröffnet mit einem Film, dann einen Vortrag im Maxi, das ist ein großes Museum, ein modernes Museum hier in Rom. Dann haben wir eine Konferenz gemacht über die Bauhausfrauen bei uns. Wir haben im RUFA, das ist eine andere Universität, die Architektur, Kunst, Design vereint, eine Ausstellung gemacht. Wir machen morgen im Sala Uno die Ausstellung mit Ihnen und heute haben wir diese hervorragende Konferenz hier. Io vorrei ringraziare a tutti che hanno partecipato, soprattutto alla signora professoressa Trovalucci qui vicino da me, al vice direttore qui dell'università e anche soprattutto a voi che siete qui con noi per partecipare in questa conferenza. Vielen Dank an Sie alle, dass Sie da sind. Grazie mille.
E adesso invito l'architetto Taviano D'Egidio a presentare le attività della sala espositiva. dove domani troverete i lavori dei ragazzi del Bauhaus. Oh, a proposito, i lavori dei ragazzi del Bauhaus sono comunque proiettati nel video che si trova nella sala accanto quando avrete occasione di passare, insieme ai lavori dei nostri laureati, ovviamente.
Una buona giornata a tutti, è una grande gioia essere qui insieme a voi. Siamo qui presenti con la Sala 1, che è un centro di cultura vicino, dietro alla Scala Santa e annesso alla Scala Santa, e la Fondazione Tito Amodei. È un ambiente religioso, ma non confessionale. Sono molti anni che lavoriamo nel settore dell'arte, e ora siamo molto interessati anche a questo tema che c'è oggi, perché o noi dominiamo i rifiuti o i rifiuti dominano noi. Quindi siamo molto interessati a fare una presenza e a vederla anche dal nostro aspetto e dal nostro spazio lì alla Scala Santa, dietro ai locali sacri del Santa Santorum. Quindi volevo dire il nostro apprezzamento per questa conferenza e il nostro apprezzamento per questo evento che ci fa riflettere. È una ricerca che va fatta, perché non è soltanto un fatto pragmatico, ma è una ricerca per utilizzare le cose che abbiamo, non soltanto una volta, ma due, tre, quattro, cinque volte, per vedere usi diversi e non lasciarsi sopraffare. Ecco, quindi voglio ringraziare di questa presenza, è molto importante. Domani pomeriggio poi ci vedremo lì chi viene. Siamo lì a Sala 1 per riflettere su queste cose e su altre, e sulle esperienze che stiamo portando avanti in riferimento al riciclo. Grazie.
Grazie. And now wish to invite Professor Litzbach Huber, that is our main host, and to present the works of his staff. Her staff, sorry.
Buongiorno, good day. I would like to.
We would like to start your.
Okay, yep. Yeah. My PowerPoint?
Did you upload to the
PowerPoint? Yeah, he has it. So, I would like to begin, I'll be speaking in English, by thanking Professor Trovalucci and the Faculty of Architecture for this opportunity to speak at the conference today. We are here in Rome to celebrate the international and nomadic history of the Bauhaus. We transported the works of art that you'll see today, or tomorrow, in suitcases, and our lectures on a data stick to be shared with all of you. The lectures build on each other and focus on different aspects of teaching and research at the Bauhaus University. At the end of the day, we hope that you will have an idea of the way that we reassess material. We would like to invite all of you to the opening of the exhibition Ripensare la Materia at Sala 1 tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. Many thanks to Mariangela Schroth and her team at Sala 1, Padre Ottaviano, for this opportunity. And many thanks to our partners and hosts at the Goethe Institute. Professor Trovalucci has asked me to begin my lecture with a brief introduction to the Bauhaus University Weimar. The Bauhaus, the most influential design school of the 20th century, was founded in 1919 in Weimar by Walter Gropius, Teachers included Gunter Stolzel, Oskar Schlemmer, Paul Klee, Vasily Kandinsky, Lionel Feininger, and Johannes Itten. Here you see the two major buildings, which were built by the Belgian architect and designer Henry van der Velde at the beginning of the 20th century. This is the Winkelbau, the van der Velde workshop building. You find in that building frescoes from Oskar Schlemmer, which were reconstructed after the Second World War because they were destroyed by the Nazis. This is an image of the main building where the Faculty of Architecture is located and part of the free art, the painting department is located here as well. In the main building, you have a series of frescoes by Herbert Bayer, also reconstructions. This is the stairwell leading to the Gropius Zimmer, to the Gropius room, the office, which was located on the first floor. And you'll see in these frescoes that the main forms of the Bauhaus, the triangle, the circle, and the square, are represented. This is an image of the Gropius Zimmer, which was reconstructed. Once again, it didn't exist anymore because the Nazis tore it down, threw it out. And you also see a tapestry by Gunter Stolzel hanging on the door. Starting with the Art Academy in 1860, there has always been an art school in Weimar. The founding of the Bauhaus at the site of the former Kunstgewerbeschule was a result of the social political upheaval after World War I. Weimar was at the epicenter. In 1919, in the same year as the founding of the Bauhaus, the National Assembly established the first German democracy, the Weimar Republic. Post-war conditions initially led to an increased cooperation between free art and skilled crafts. While I'm speaking, I'm going to show you images of the faculty as it is today. I think they explain themselves. This is the plaster and form building shop. The previous was a shot of the wood shop. This is the photography area. In that process, there was a communication and inspiration between the disciplines. The products created in the shops also contributed to the support of the Bauhaus, since state funding was very scarce. In time, the free and utopian spirit of the early Bauhaus changed due to political and economic pressures. A close cooperation with industry began, in which commercially attractive prototypes were designed for mass production. With the rise of the Reich, the Bauhaus was forced out of Thuringia and moved from Weimar to Dessau in 1925, then from Dessau to Berlin in 1932, and in 1933, when Hitler came to power, the Bauhaus was dissolved. Most of its members emigrated. In the United States, up until today, studies in art, design, and architecture are based on the Bauhaus model. In Weimar today, the link to the Bauhaus history was made when, after the political upheaval of 1989, the Faculty of Art and Design was founded with the intention of bringing art and design back to the Bauhaus. That was in 1993. In 1996, the school was renamed Bauhaus Universität Weimar with four faculties, art and design, architecture and urbanism, civil engineering and media. The Bauhaus University offers a range of 40 courses, from fine arts and product design to media art and design, media culture, environmental engineering, civil engineering, and architecture and urbanism. Currently, there are 4,000 students enrolled at the Bauhaus University Weimar, including 450 foreign students. This is the metal shop, the university library. This is a critique session of artwork at the end of our semester. And there's lots of Bauhaus parties, which we love. So now I will move into the other part of my lecture, which is called Transition and Transformation Processes. Our interdisciplinary excursions are based on the Bauhaus project legacy, which promotes crossing disciplinary boundaries to investigate issues from a technical as well as an artistic point of view. In order to gain a complex and multifaceted understanding of a problem, in this process, artists confront the same real-world issues as engineers and create works in which initiate a change in individual and public perception through artistic means, and this is important to us. Artists don't become engineers. Engineers don't become artists. Rather, we work together and present different aspects of the same problem in order to expand horizons. The case in point in this lecture is the Mexican-American border at Tijuana, San Diego. The Mexican-American border wall that runs through the cities of Tijuana, San Diego is physical, a social and political flashpoint prototypical of the conflict potential in globalization. The border wall not only brutally divides the landscape and the population of a shared culture and language, but also wreaks havoc environmentally in terms of interrupted watershed and waste systems. Our research at the border connects artists who work in the public realm with urban planners and environmental engineers whose focus is on the infrastructure of water and waste. The interest that connects the found object in art to infrastructural challenges in creative management of wastewater and trash is the inherent value of used material. Who determines the criteria and who decides when material is worthless? In November 2013, we were the very first cross-disciplinary excursion with the Bauhaus University's artists, engineers, and urbanists. The second interdisciplinary trip took place in September 2016 and once again investigated the border situation, but also the changes that had occurred since 2013. Donald Trump was on his way. Transition and transformation processes were the central themes of our trip. We began our investigations from a bottom-up perspective and utilized the holistic approach common to community-based and activist art in order to address issues that resonated with all of our disciplines. In both San Diego and Tijuana, our guides were from NGOs and community-based arts organizations. The works by German, American, and Mexican artists who had been on excursion exhibited together as the Border City Collective in the exhibition Skyjacking Above, Tunnel Below, Deconstructing the Border at the Neue Gesellschaft für Bildende Kunst in Berlin from August to October 2017. The production of urban space is a focal point of human desire, tied to ideas of affluence, independence, opportunity, and happiness. This is not working. Oh, wait, just a minute, it was just stuck. Okay. Hope radiates magically from urban centers, and the future of a city is guaranteed by its ability to meet expectations. Citizens need the opportunity to articulate their hopes and to have a voice in changes that affect their daily lives. Cities and their populations are a living, changing organism involved in a permanent process of adjustment and adaptation. A major challenge to be faced is the continuous and extensive infrastructural development in the expanding urban agglomerations of the globalized world. Is it possible to develop a new understanding of cities through the relationships of the people in them and to organize the cities accordingly? Functionality, decoration, and the value of materials differ on each side of the Mexican-American border. Spending time in San Diego and in Tijuana, I have been fascinated by the fact that what is declared trash in San Diego has tremendous value just on the other side of the border, in Tijuana. For example, in order to clear urban and suburban space to make room for MEC mansions, entire tracts of standard-sized single-family bungalows from the 60s were transported to Tijuana, from San Diego to Tijuana on the backs of flatbed trucks. In Tijuana, these houses were heaved with a crane onto a row house system of steel girders designed by Estudio Teddy Cruz, leaving the space below the house vacant to be transformed into a workplace, a small shop, or a car park. Zoning regulations in the USA don't permit commercial and residential mixed use. In Mexico, there are no regulations to prevent this. Other examples of material and value transformations are seen in the used tires slit into strips and carefully woven into retaining walls filled with gravel to combat increasing erosion due to global warming. Garage doors from San Diego become walls of houses in Tijuana. A row of colorful car hoods affording shelter from the sun with empty glass bottles set into the concrete supporting posts create decorative color and light. Materials take on unique forms and aesthetics, reflecting differing value systems. Of great interest to us on this excursion was how each individual participant perceived, interpreted, and responded to a unique context using the skills available to him or her. At this point in time, with the curriculum at the Bauhaus University the way it is today, the disciplinary responses are related but parallel reactions to the same stimulus. In a context of mutual respect, this expands perspectives and the horizons of all participants and the tolerance of the other. However, the solutions or proposals remain individual, based on one's disciplinary skill set. There is not one integrated solution, rather, these differing disciplinary proposals are facets of perception that give insight into the complexity of the problematic. The next curricular step would be to train artists in basic principles of environmental engineering and to train engineers in, for example, relational aesthetics. This is a term coined by the French curator Nicolas Bourriard in the 90s to describe art based on or inspired by human relations in their social context. An integrated collaboration could be possible in the next and coming generations. Spending time together and creating space for discussions is the first step in joint research and problem solving. This experience may well lead to the discovery of a common ground in the response, which could enable the next steps of setting goals and developing a strategy of intervention to bring about positive change. Thank you. I just wanted to make a few comments about the remaining photos. I'm showing you now a place run by the Catholic Church in Tijuana to serve breakfast to refugees. So every day they have a highly organized system of serving breakfast We participated 1 or 2 days and were volunteers. Tijuana is a global waiting room. The refugees hoping, coming from all over Latin America, coming from Haiti, from Africa, from the Middle East, are trapped in Tijuana and waiting to get to the United States. This is an organization that feeds them. And there's been a tremendous engagement on the part of the citizens of Tijuana for the refugees. This is an artist, Marcos Ramirez, and this is a photo of our excursion group. Thank you.
I just want to introduce myself for a short presentation of our work of the last 4 years.
So, good morning again. And first of all, let me thank Professor Liz Pachhuber for selecting our faculty for celebrating the centenary of, let me say, legendary school of Bauhaus in our faculty. And painting, sculpture, and architecture was the main disciplines taught at the school, as is shown in the original manifesto of the school. But as well known, many disciplines were taught in this school of applied arts and technology: photography, theater, typography, and advertising graphics, and so on, by many very prestigious teachers. Always focusing on both theoretical background and practical outcomes. And I want to say that this year also our Faculty of Architecture celebrates his centenary from its foundation, and his founder, the engineer Gustavo Giovannoni, wanted a school inspired to the unity of humanistic and scientific culture. And I wish, of course, thanks also our dean that hosts today this event. And for the architects who formed in this school, and in particular from those of my generation, it is very important to remember the founding principles of Walter Gropius' essentially political program, inspired at the definition of a rational method to form new generations, and then the society from its birth. In that time, there was the primary necessity to rebirth after the Great War, but at present, we'll always feel the need to recover the role of the culture as a force able to control and contrast the intrinsically divisive trends of economy and politics. And this is stated in our constitution. The original project of Gropius to put the art in the service of the industry now assumed the exasperated tones of placing everything, art, music, humanities, etc., in the service of the market. Business creativity is the term that Liz used, and I fully agree with her thought that university must remain a locus of resistance to the project of fully commercialized creativity, but not only creativity, to for following short-sighted economic gains. These are themes that need deepenings that are not exactly in agenda today, but they offered me the opportunity to introduce the inspiring principle of the graduation atelier of Ecological Island and reuse centers, lab recyclings that acts in this faculty since 2014. This laboratory was born by an idea of the dean of the time, that was Professor Renato Masiani, that is now our vice rector, who made an assigned an agreement with the municipal hygiene company of Rome, AMA, and this is a scientific, the current scientific committee. Referring to the Bauhaus teaching, the widely advertised principle of learning through doing is guaranteed here by the collaboration with the AMA staff. And part of the lessons of this course were developed within this faculty by ex-cathedra lessons, and the other part is developed at the premises of the company in contact with the various professional technicians during the developing of a project of architecture. And this means theory and applications within an interdisciplinary experience from the ideation to the a concrete realizable project. And while healing the dichotomy between academia and municipality, that is the reality now, always looking at the social aim of teaching, we want to make students aware of the general problem of overproduction and it's the related problems of waste disposal and or management that in the contemporary metropolis assumes high enormous proportions. This by forming professionals able to propose architectural design solutions aimed at improving the quality of life. I don't, very, very shortly, because the teachers and the students will enter into details afterwards today. I just want to focus that the central theme of the Atelier Lab Recyclings is the study for the definition of new architectural typologies, eco, recycling, and reuse centers, addressed to the waste differentiated collection, recycle, and or recovery, reuse, by taking into account all the technological, economic, and social aspects linked to themes of great current interest and prominence, which constitute the foundation of a new civilization of recovery, reuse, eco-sustainable development, and in which politics and academia must have a central role. This, the teams treated within this laboratory atelier are different because we have a staff within the laboratory, and for instance, students are addressed to design an ecological island where materials were collected, or a reuse center where objects are brought and then restored for a new use, or also to face to the investigation of sustainable technologies for the functional improvement of an eco-center, or even to think to a so-called waste urban plan that is essential in any, for instance, metropolitan context. And I want to highlight that this project goes well beyond the technical dimension. as it can invest issues related to, for instance, to requalification of the urban countryside, the recovery of collective memory, deconstruction of identitary places in the fragmented contemporary metropolitan realities, and so on. And in this sense, in a word, it properly connoted as a project of architecture. Architecture which rediscovers its social role, remembering that its ultimate goal is improving the quality of life, as I said before. And Lab Recycling has been the occasion of a cultural and professional exchange between academia and the external. And by exploiting the contribution of a very special staff, that is the AMA staff, coordinated by the architect Roberto Panei, and with a team of professional technicians, electrotechnical, structural, thermohydraulic, and environmental engineers. Some of, of them will show their approach hereafter. And this is exactly an educational experimentation between theory and applications, in which the AMA technicians address the students to the issues of reuse, maintenance, repair, refurbishment, selection, classification, and so on. And the result is a concrete designing experience aimed at the realization of architecture for waste collection, including municipal spaces for exhibition, for instance, of the objects restored in use. And you can see many projects exposed at the next door room. Our common aim is to provide the cultural conditions for the formation of a new civilization of recovery and reuse and eco-sustainable development, in the sense that if we cannot stop the production, focus should be at least on saving goods, materials, energy, etc. And some authors will deal today about circular economy, for instance, engineer Petrucciani that will expose his talk right now. And our students will show it already that this goal can be achieved through the lesson of architecture, starting from an original idea, concept, that you can see all is often inspired to evocative forms with a symbolic content, but never to the final outcome, never neglecting the construction real issues. And the projects of our students have been exposed in several occasions, as Venezia Biennale of Architecture and other occasions. And you can find a book where we collected some selected projects at the desk out here, and also a selection of some project that will be also exposed directly by our students in the afternoon. So here today, the different experience of two academic realities, Sapienza and Bauhaus, together with external realities, AMA, Goethe Institute, Sala 1, etc., today meet and compare each other. In such a way, this event became a moment of synthesis and encounter between the two fundamental aspects of waste, recovery, reuse. The design of architectural typologies destined to the functions of separate collection of waste, recycling, and the recovery of disused objects for a new use or artistic manipulation of these. Upcycling, we call this creative reuse. And let me conclude by showing what is a sort of symbol of the today event. It is inspired both at the arts and crafts practical experience of Bauhaus and to the principle of creative reuse. This is a hat that you can show here. Enjoy, and that is conceived and then realized by the architect Natalia Varisella, who was a student of mine. And let me open the works of the day by highlighting that, differently from some positions critical to the social reality, that in the past have had right importance in the contemporary art scene, we want here to propose a constructive point of view for the development of a new sustainable society. And thanks to the speakers, thanks to the students, thanks to everybody for being here, and let's make the works start. Thank you. And now I wish to invite architect Panay, who will explain you the content of the graduation atelier that I introduced in some details by highlighting the needs of collaboration between academia and the external.
So, good morning to everyone. And first of all, I would like to thank the Dean of the Faculty, Anna Maria, Professor Anna Maria Giovenal, the Vice Dean, Professor Luca Ribichini, to strong support this this collaboration with AMA. The Professor Masiani, the Vice Rector of Sapienza University, for supporting from for believing from the beginning to this collaboration. And of course, Professor Patrizia Trovalucci, who allowed us to organize this event. In this regard, I send the greeting from the CEO of AMA, architect Massimo Bagatti, who due to unexpected commitments cannot participate today. With this brief presentation, I'm going to illustrate the work of the graduation laboratory. After the introduction of Professor Trovalucci, we can confirm that the synthesis between operational research and theoretical experimentation turns out to be the focus of this experience. On one side, on the left, the legislation with the strict rules and accompany that the AMA, that must concretely identify public areas and properties to be used to tend towards the optimization of the service. On the other side, the university that with its students competes to invent new architectural types, new spaces to be organized according to operational needs, together with the same finality, acquiring a design approach based on the feasibility of the project. The social role of that architecture must have is highlighted mostly in this case where the activity concerns the interest of citizens who also have to play a fundamental role. In this regard, a group of qualified technicians interacts with the graduating students, providing support and actively participating with ex-cathedra lessons and periodic reviews of the projects. The attention is focused on sustainable approaches, from photovoltaic to bioclimatic greenhouses, from bamboo structures to straw bale walls. All aspects contributing to transform a drawing in a project are developed. The result is the synthesis of all issues involved, structure, technology, plant. This without neglecting the form, the idea of architecture that always must ride the project itself. This is therefore the context in which the recycling lab is developed, during which the aspects relating to recycling and reuse were mainly investigated by designing ecological islands and creative for reuse center. And, but now we have to try to understand what are an ecological island and what is a creative reuse center. Over the last year, the need to organize places for the performance of the service for the separate collection of waste has led to the conception of a new architectural typology. In accordance with the current regulation of the matter, to define what an ecological island is, we have highlighted four aspects. The first one is, of course, the functionality, the place we have where you can store non-organic waste. The second one is the accessibility. It has to be near houses. The third one is the relationship with the urban context, because we are living and operating in a city, of course. The fourth one is the modularity, fundamental for the functionality of the from classical module to the current module, the speech does not change with the necessary distinction, of course, but it's always a question of organizing the project on a basic element that gives the measure to the composition. In our case, the organizing elements are, that one on the left, are the standard waste container and also the measures of the transport vehicles. On this basis, of the previous reasonings, invariant characteristics have been identified and a standard project has been elaborated by our office in AMA, starting from the analysis of the basic elements and activities of the functional program, as you can see above. This one is one of the latest realization of AMA, is the ecological island in Via della Bufalotta, here in Rome. And now let's see what a creative reuse center is. It's a place open to all citizens that integrates the functions of an ecological island by intercepting all those objects that are destined to become waste, by proposing a new use for them and thus reducing the production of waste. In particular, this integration is carried out through an activity that we call triage, like Engineer Petrucciani suggests. And as in hospitals, in order to be able to better identify the activities to be undertaken. On the one hand, on the right, the objects to be recovered even in a creative way. On the other hand, the ones that instead become waste for recycling. In the scheme conceived by the engineer Sulis, it's summarized as the linear economy even through the reuse, however, tends to make the objects lose value. The creative intervention, giving another value, reverses this trend by reinventing a new function that determines a new life cycle of the object that will be used as if it were new. Objects apparently devoid of value and function are here reused, not according to their original use, but activating new expressive, creative, and communicative possibilities. Here we can see a typical scheme of a reuse center where the various planet activities are summarized with the warehouse in the center. And some images, in particular one of the most famous centers, that of Berkeley in California. However, these are always warehouses not designed for this purpose, but adapted to the needs, as can be easily perceived from the pictures. Our intention is to think of the spaces commensurate with the needs and designed according to their use. And to better organize the work of the students' project requirements, project requirements have been defined and summarized in the project. Finally, particular importance was given to the choice of areas. To increase the truthfulness of the operation, no abstract location have been identified. The urban place used for the experimentation of the degree projects are public lots with an urban planning destination according with the purpose of AMA and the municipality of Rome. Usually, like in the picture, they are areas located in the Roman suburbs, in zone mainly without service and quite degraded. All of these issues which I'm talking about are the topics that form the basis for allowing students for the preparation of the degree projects. In the picture we can see a panel of a degree thesis. The arguments illustrated during the lesson are synthesized in some panels where all themes are reorganized in a personal way, and where in the analysis of the urban areas are highlighted urbanistic and environmental constraints. From here, every student starts to derive the cues to propose the project idea, often arising from suggestions that have little to do with architecture, but that during the workshop are guided, with the help of the professional staff, towards a realization and concretization of the initial choices. The illustration of some degree projects will come later in the afternoon, but now I would like to highlight some characteristic aspects of the work carried out by the students. First of all, it's interesting to note how the idea coming from the concept of circular economy is the one that, inevitably, I think, has had more success. From the circle to the pinwheel, passing through a whole series of architectures where the beginning and the end coincide, almost always, I can see. In particular, I would like to show how the design process, starting from a highly abstract idea, has then produced a credible and very concrete result, corrected both from a distribution and functional point of view. Starting from the left, from the Third Paradise by Michelangelo Pistoletto, the starting point is taken to design three areas that embody nature, the ecological island, artifice, the center of use, and the rebirth represented by the exhibition area in the center of the composition. In the second example, we start from the life cycle of the objects to arrive at the conception of a cylindrical artifact based on a structure consisting of steel portals which host all the functions necessary for the activity of reuse. The third case takes its cue from origami and, in any case, from paper that, curled up or folded, is among ultimately the most reused material. The project foresees an ecological island and a creative reuse center strongly integrated in a circular path. In the last example, we start with a flower and its corolla. However, it is a particular flower, the lotus flower, whose peculiarity lies in its ability to remain pure and clean while sinking its roots in the mud. Hence the development of the project that winds along to circular building intersected to define a space that is the barycenter of the entire composition, both formal and functional. The same applies to the design choices that have privileged the visual impact, with the form that becomes a true icon representative of a message. Basically, the message that weighs finally can also be glamorous. Starting on from the left, also in this case, it is interesting to see how sometimes the starting points are really extreme. The glass bottle, the object that always been reused, becomes the exhibition pavilion of the Creative Reuse Center. A simple steel structure composed of arches of different radius connected to each other by transverse stiffeners makes up the shape of the pavilion bottle, where the label is interpreted by a glass surface. Absolutely fantastic in the center is the DNA-based approach as a generator of life, in this case, second life for objects, and which turns into a rotating solid made with the Grasshopper software and subsequently designed with linear steel elements. Also in this case, the integration between ecological island and reuse center is very well satisfied. Finally, bees and their ability to produce food like honey from waste. The beehive with hexagons becomes the distribution scheme created by structural umbrellas with a reinforced concrete pillar and laminated wood beams, sometimes left free as contained cover, in other cases delimited by infill walls also in wood. The hypogeum approach represents an important variation to the exposition of the explicit form, not for reasons related to the desire not to appear, but especially when one is forced by stringent constraints. In some cases, the structure was developed underground. In this regard, we see two proposals from the same area, where contiguous to an existing ecological island, a reuse center is designed to integrate and complete the functions. In the first case on the left, the reference is the one of the masters of contemporary architecture, Louis Kahn, where the sequence of space juxtaposed with an apparent randomness becomes the characteristic feature of the functionally flawless project. From storage to laboratories for maintenance activities, passing through the service areas located in a central position up to the exhibition hall, which can be accessed independently. In the second case, instead, the queue is provided by the contour lines of the hill under which the project is located. The curves approximated to a line with an inflection point become the generators of the structural scheme. In these last examples, the reference to the standard scheme of the ecological island we have seen before is evident. On the left, a plate set on a regular structural step that directly derives from that of the standard, as if it were an extension of that, to also integrate the functions of reuse center. The original idea develops around a hollowed out square that becomes the central nucleus of the intervention and an urban gathering place. On the right, instead, a sort of agricultural farmhouse with its enclosure, it is an area located in the Roman countryside, also starts from the structural step of the standard ecological island, developing it, however, in a linear way. The composition is completed with a small pavilion, the central fulcrum of the system, on which, like a small sighting tower, the wind generator is set. A separate case concerns research carried out in the field of urban planning. At the base is the search for a shared methodology of selection and identification of areas compatible with the infrastructures necessary for the performance of the urban hygiene service. The goal is to translate into an algorithm of operational research the needs to localize areas where to place urban hygiene infrastructures, taking into account all the present constraints. Thematics maps are elaborated to support the decision, clearing the field as much as possible from subjective and extemporaneous approaches. Both the works here represented start from the same assumption, from the urban analysis based on territorial surveys to the use of information systems with digitized databases. In the first case on the left, a classical territorial survey identifies by verifying the condition and criteria of proximity and catchment five homogeneous areas in which it is possible to place as many ecological islands. On the right, an analogous methodology is developed through vectorized databases, which progressively, we say in the afternoon with the students, allow, depending on the different parameters highlighted, to skim the number of suitable areas. In the images, the example of water courses with buffers in evidence. I'm going to conclude this overview confirming that all the projects carried out by the students have tried, in various cases with success, to create a synthesis between the various components of the architecture, an approach that should be the basis of any effective realization. The formal and symbolic aspects have always been verified and compared with the distribution needs and with the in-depth studies regarding the structural and plant engineering issues. The inevitable compromises that must be faced during the evolution of the project have always been solved by following the direction set with the conception of the initial idea, in an attempt to exploit the technical imposition to improve the project. In this regard, the example of the great architects of the past must always be present to demonstrate the possibility of development that, starting from the idea expressed with a quick sketch, cross the always tortoise design and realization process, concludes with a final image that actually is incredibly similar to the initial one. So at the end, I would like to say once again that the main objective of this course is thus the formation of a double awareness in students, the discovery of a social role of architecture capable of improving the quality of life, and at the same time, the acquisition of a design approach oriented to work feasibility. All students showed a great interest and they were very even excited about this experience. We will continue to sensitize them in this subject that, as I said, is not simply aimed to train designers, but also to raise awareness of young citizens toward primary social issues. Thank you.
And now I want to invite our lecturer, Professor Barbera, who will expose you his point of view on very general, with a very general approach. Thank you for coming.
Good morning. I'm very sorry not to speak in German. I should, because I used to frequent for family commitment Germany for, let's say, 10 years. I have a German daughter. So my German language is that to speak to a kid. It is less than a kiddish German. So I'm obliged to speak English, but my conversation with you will be very short for two main reasons. First, I am an architect, an old architect. I am a professor of architecture and urban design. And I do teach still in a very old way. So I am here for learning, not for teaching anything. But I have a certain experience of the world because my role as chairholder of a UNESCO chair brings me around the world everywhere, in China, in Africa, in Asia, in Europe, of course. And so I formed an idea about architecture, some ideas about architecture. And I think here I would like to stress the meaning of architecture as maybe the most important producer of waste. I had a little discussion with Professor Anna Del Monaco about the title of my conversation. At the beginning it was between landfill and urban anemia. Then we decide now between urban landfill and urban anemia. Now it is social landfill and urban anemia. Maybe we'll never stop this discussion, but now it is like that. The second reason why you are lucky is the fact that I prepared for your benefit a little video at the end that lasts 3 minutes. So they told me that I have to speak no more than 15 minutes. If you take away the minutes that I already lost here in the beginning, plus 3 minutes at the end, I will speak for 5 minutes. Well, I will start with Mussolini. This is a very famous picture, two pictures. The first one is a real photograph picture. The second one is the exaltation of this picture. He was very proud to be the leader of the producers of building waste, destroying and producing waste, the historical urban fabric of Rome. Less people know that in 1930, the same years in which Mussolini uses power to destroy architecture, there was a deed of the municipality of Rome, that at that time it was called governatorate. The deed was this: families of construction workers, brackets, the construction workers that immigrated from the countryside to build the fastest capital town, were not allowed to live in town. They have to go away each night. In the countryside around the town. So, family of construction workers, families expelled from demolished areas of the historic center, because of course, if you destroy architecture, you make not only architectural waste, but also social waste. And families of uncertain morality altogether can build their own settlements outside the urban perimeter and away from the consular roads. The consular roads are the main roads for connecting the main cities of Italy. As construction aid to these families, the building material resulting from the demolitions in the historic center can be provided. Marvelous coincidence. Architectural waste and social waste together form an equilibrium, unbelievable equilibrium. This is why around Rome, while the official Rome was built somehow also architecturally in an interesting way, there was a second Rome built, I don't know if with the waste from the historical center demolitions, but anyway, this kind of Rome. At the end of the Second World War, the number of people living in the two different Romes were approximately the same. And I think the Borgate Romane, because the name of those settlements is maybe more famous as Borgate Romane, is the coincidence, it represents the coincidence of architectural waste and social waste. And of course, afterwards, there were some aids, more, let's say, in a more civil way, but the sense of abandonment, of solitude, remain in that outskirt, to the point that a great Italian poet of the second half of last century, Pier Paolo Pasolini, made of these places and of these people, the scenery of his poetic revolutionary sensitivity. China, great. This is the new China, but it could be the new Sao Paulo in Brazil, and maybe in a few years, I don't know, the new European town. Full of people. But sometimes I wonder, if something changes in the economic waves in the world, what to do with those buildings? What an amount of, enormous amount of architectural waste, how to digest it. But anyway, within this kind of very pride, very powerful new way to produce a town, there are still the same kind of coincidence of the double waste, social and architectural, represented by what it is called the phenomenon of the villages in the city. The villages in the cities in China are something different from the barriadas or favelas in South America, because they pre-existed before the town was born, the modern town was born. They were little, and we will see not very little, agricultural villages. They were left isolated inside the bulk, the body of the modern metropolis. And as the country, as the people immigrating from the countryside in millions and millions, in tens and hundreds of millions, to the towns, are not allowed to live in town, exactly like 1930 in Italy. Where do they go? They go to the old, former villages, and they fill them up to make a coincidence again between social waste and building waste. But we have not to wait so long to see the problem that this very powerful new metropolitan architecture can produce. There are already ghost cities. And I think it will be very difficult, much more difficult, to make our planet digest this kind of waste than the waste that we already saw in Rome 1930 and in the villages within the town in China. What to do with this material? China. I take China as a, first of all, because I know it. I know this country. I cannot say very well, but I know it. I frequent it. This is the town. That is the countryside. The countryside. We have seen already an example of what I call urban anemia, people that went away from a town, or maybe never lived there. Urban anemia. But there is also a more evident, a countryside anemia. Now, in this very moment, in China, I think there are approximately 500 million people that have to move from the countryside to a certain urban new settlement. Because if China wants to be really in all its part and a modern country, the number of people working in agriculture must be reduced tremendously. Now it is approximately between 40% of the population, it must be reduced to 10-5%. So there is the country is making an enormous effort to manage this problem. Then there is the countryside anemia, people leaving the countryside, leaving the houses, leaving the historical villages. And it is another enormous amount of architectural waste. And it happened to me, to Professor Anna Del Monaco, to be invited last year to visit a tentative, an experiment to transform this enormous amount of agricultural settlements in something else, to reuse them. The experiment was to transform them in tourist villages. The experiment was very nice, I must tell you. Very well designed, very well organized. But can you imagine to transform in tourist villages the houses that now are the living place for 500 million people? Because the countryside in China is not the countryside that you can see in Italy or in Germany. This is the enormous fabric of an agricultural comune. So they, while they are preparing little towns, middle-sized towns, and so on, to guest the immigration from the countryside, in the same time, they have to face the countryside anemia and what to do with this enormous amount of building volumes. I don't have any solution. I just want to talk with you about this problem. Of course, also in Italy, in our very small country, the problem of abandoned villages is very present. The abandonment, yes, sometimes depends on the morphological, let's say, geological problems, but mainly from the emigration from the villages to the towns. There are many villages, many old villages, but there are also new villages completely abandoned because they were built within the framework of progressive projects of rehabilitation, social rehabilitation. But those projects did not take into account the fact that the waves of history are much more fast than the building of a new village. So in Sicily, there are, not only in Sicily, but for instance, in Sicily, there are areas and spots in which you can find, beside the very beautiful historical villages and towns, empty villages, never inhabited, or very freshly abandoned. It is this happened also in the last century. Here is a map, I don't know how understandable, but of the places in which this phenomenon in Italy is relevant. But there is another much more important phenomenon in the world that produces, I think, another enormous amount of architectural waste. It is the phenomenon of the shrinking cities. We are in 1965. I don't know if in the screen is visible the growth of the phenomenon all around the world. And this is the forecast. Detroit is the capital town of this. Detroit, who was one of the most important industrial towns of the world. The history changed, the technology changed, the needs of the human beings changed. Detroit is not a shrinking town, a dying town. Of course, there are artists, communities of of interesting people who try to make a good use of this, but the amount, the number of houses, of buildings, of industries abandoned, I think overwhelms any, positive effort. Detroit. And there are other phenomena coming. The drought that affects large parts of the world are really a very strong push for immigration from immigrating from those countries, in which there are also some modern metropolis and old and historical towns and system of historical towns and modern cities. And another phenomenon that conflicts with the run towards the metropolitan areas is the sea level rise. Here in South America, the sea level rise affects what? The big cities. Why the people from the inner country tries to go. So Sao Paulo, Rio de Janeiro. And so the conflict between the sea level rise and the arriving of the population, then the problem to be destined to abandon the places in which maybe they just settled for a while. I think it is dramatic. Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is one of those examples. Puerto Rico is a very little island, very important because it belongs to the state, to the United States, maybe could become a sort of laboratory for many, many, many other parts of the world. Now, is this a waste of building material or a waste of social material? I think there is a coincidence, exactly the same coincidence, the darkest side, the coincidence that Mussolini wanted to imagine for Rome. Now, I would like to, if somebody helps me, to show you a little. A little video. This video is a fragment of a very famous Italian film of the year 1960, the director, the film director, was Michelangelo Antonioni. You are too young to remember this name. It was a very important film from the stylistic point of view, and also the atmosphere, very abstract atmosphere. 1960 was a special year, and now I invite you not to listen to me anymore, but just to read the titles that I put in this. It is a fragment.
C'è nessuno? Oh! Senti l'eco, come mai è vuoto?
Chi lo sa? Io mi domando perché l'hanno costruita. Ce n'è un altro.
Quello non è un paese, è un cimitero. Dio mio, come triste. Andiamo via.
Professor Barbera, for this general overview of this kind of waste that we have to recover with a lot of care. And now we can stop the works for a while. And we can start again after 15 minutes. Thank you. And for guests, there is in the next door coffee break.